what people say. And I was fortunate to be with him in the Harvard University at Boston for 10 days on the Project Zero program, hence the dedication. So we are looking at the broad outcomes that we would be able to attain today. We are going to look at how we can infer that intelligences are not necessarily cognitive. This is one of the most important areas that Dr. Gardner, he broke the theory and the trends that intelligence is measured by cognitive intelligence. So today we are going to look at how intelligences need not necessarily be cognitive. Secondly, we are going to look at those 9 types of intelligences propounded by Gardner and relevance to education. We will be enabled to design teaching activities that are linked to the multiple intelligences, materials that are relevant, and we are also going to take a look at some associated careers. Then enabling the design of instructional material that can help you promote multiple intelligence in classrooms, and you may apply these strategies or modify them. And most importantly, you would be able to design your lesson plan based on your understanding of these multiple intelligences. So I think the chat box is already enabled. I would like you to put up in the chat box 3 questions. What's your definition of intelligence, the way you look at it? What do you mean by this term intelligence? And whom would you call an intelligent child in your class and why? Can you recall the name of a child whom you call as intelligent? What traits of this child are you talking about when you say this child is intelligent? So quickly share in the chat box any of these questions or all of them very quickly. What's your definition of intelligence? Whom would you call an intelligent child? Yeah, somebody says memory, mental activity, deal with the situation. Okay, acquire skills and knowledge. Okay, what else? Thinking out of box. Okay, logical thinker, smart skills. Okay, presence of mind, being very proactive, smart answering. Okay, deal with situations. Many of you say that ability to apply skills, problem solving, adapting to situations, quick decision making, can deal with ideas, creativity, ability to understand, problem solving, and so on. Okay. Express their talents in the best way possible. Yes. So if you can now recall in your own minds any child whom you called intelligent, intelligence is the reception and processing information. Definition. So can you recall the name of any child whom you call as intelligent? So most importantly, more than the name, we're looking at what traits did you find in this child to call that child intelligent? What traits did you find in this particular child or children? Solving intellectual, physical problems, okay. Can we come down to children now? Grasping power, diverge, thinking skills, all right. Very good. And sharp, okay. Ability to answer, lifelong learning questions, understands very quickly, questioning ability. Okay. So according to most of us, we look at intelligence from various angles. And I'm so glad to see that most of us here are not thinking about intelligence in terms of the marks that they get due to their recall of questions for an examination, and therefore such children who get 100 are all necessarily intelligent, all others are not. So this theory has been debunked by Dr. Gardner. We are going to take a look. I want you to try today. We cannot actually ask you to show your video cameras and switch on your cameras. It's not permitted today because of the large numbers, but I would like you all to try out this little exercise with your children when you go back to school, with your students. You take a blank piece of paper, you can even do it now, and you draw a butterfly using all the colors that you wish to have on that butterfly. with whatever materials, and you can add on your own settings to that screen, to the scene with that butterfly. So if we had it in a shorter session, what we would be doing is, like, we could have a class of 30 children, 40 children, ask them to draw this butterfly and then color it the way they want to. Let them give it their own settings, maybe in a garden, maybe sitting on a flower or whatever, and the colors could vary. So when you examine those drawings, what do you think would be the output of those drawings? Would you have, you would have butterflies definitely on all the children's drawings, as some of you could be sketching now. But would all of these butterflies look the same? Would the settings be the same when you have given them the freedom? No. Definitely not. Got the answer. So what would we actually see? Yeah, the colors would all be different. Definitely. The settings would be different. Varieties would be there. Yes. So when we look at so many varieties and shapes of butterfly sizes, the landscape, and we know that even 40 children do not duplicate the same thing, we can conclude very easily and very simply from this exercise that all of us have different thinking patterns. That's the conclusion. And Dr. Gardner had spent many years of research doing this. Each one has different perceptions, as someone put up, yes. And the way they visualize this is going to be different. It varies from child to child, which means no two children are identical anywhere across the globe. It's almost like our fingerprints. The way people say no two fingerprints can be the same, we are unique. The same goes with our intelligences. And this is exactly what Dr. Gardner was trying to push across. So there are many definitions of intelligence, which you can see on my screen. And somebody called Boring says, intelligence is what is measured by intelligence tests. And another educationist says, a person possesses intelligence insofar as he has learned or can learn or adjust himself to the environment. Terman says, the ability to carry out abstract thinking is called intelligence. And another educationist says, the capacity for knowledge and the knowledge possessed is intelligence. And Gardner, Howard Gardner, describes intelligence as the ability to solve problems or make products that are valuable in one or more cultural settings. So through that statement, he tries to imply that if students are able to Book of Multiple Intelligences, the Stanford Binet Intelligence Test, which we use even now, called the IQ test, which was constructed in the 1900s by Alfred Binet. It talks about four elements of intelligence and measures us only through these four: the direction or the ability to work towards a goal, the adaptability to make changes and adjustments, comprehension of basic problems, and self-evaluation, knowing if the problem has been solved. And if you look at the IQ tests of Alfred Binet, you would see most of them focus on these four aspects. And they say you have a high IQ if you got a high score on this, and they say you have a low IQ, there's something wrong with your thinking if you have a low IQ, which is not true. And so this very important quote of Dr. Gardner comes in handy to talk about: anything that is worth teaching can be presented in many different ways. This is important for teachers. These multiple ways can make use of our multiple intelligence, because the brain has got pathways and pathways to learn. And these multiple pathways, which have not been fathomed by man as yet, the best way teachers can do this is to present materials in different ways, allow children to present learning in their multiple ways. Now, how does the theory of multiple intelligence become an answer to these traditional definitions? As pointed out, in 1983, the theory was defined or created by Gardner, and it places a lot of emphasis on the idea that the traditional understanding of intelligence is by means of an IQ test is far, far too limited. And then he introduced the 9 types of intelligence. 8 are commonly used, and the 9th one is being used in limited manners by teachers who have got that right. So we have nature smart people, which Gardner calls the naturalistic intelligence, people smart intelligence, or the interpersonal, how do I get along with others, the number smart intelligence, or the logical mathematical intelligence, the spatial visual called the picture smart, and linguistic is the word smart, musical being music smart, body kinesthetic being body smart, self smart being interpersonal, going within the self, meditating, reflecting, thinking to oneself. And finally, he added the 9th one called existentialism, and he's trying to probe the 10th one now. So the traditional view, as I told you, and the multiple intelligence theory, how are tests measured? Here, intelligence is measured by short answer tests. And here, short answer tests are not used because they do not measure the disciplinary mastery or deep understanding. They measure just rote memorization skills and one's ability. So he said, we cannot use short answer tests here. And the traditional view of intelligence, people are born with a fixed amount of intelligence. But Gardner says, all of us have all of these intelligences, but in different combinations. So we have an MI profile, each one of us. Some of us are highly endowed with some of the intelligences and not so highly endowed with a few. And the traditional view was intelligence cannot change over a lifetime. Gardner debunked that by saying we can improve each of the intelligences, though some people improve more readily, maybe more steadily in one intelligence area than the others. And all this has come from a lot of research that was done by the Project Zero team at the Harvard University. And then the traditional view says it consists of the ability in logic and language, 2 major areas. You look at the IQ test, the focus is on logic and language. But there are many more intelligences which reflect different ways of interacting with the world. In traditional practice, teachers teach the same stuff to all the children. But the MI pedagogy says that teachers will teach and assess differently based on individual intellectual strength and weaknesses, giving children their space. Teachers teach a topic or a subject. But in MI theory, the teachers structure the learning activities around an issue and they question or they connect subjects. They develop strategies that allow for students to demonstrate multiple ways of understanding. And the MI theory actually values the uniqueness of children. So once again, when we talk about these intelligences, what are the features of people who are endowed with these intelligences? So if you're linguistic, it means you're excelling in words. You have a flair for words. You can pick up new vocabulary very fast. You have a flair for new languages. Could be writing poetry. You could be a writer and so on. You can use language very well. You can speak well. And when it comes to the logical math, it's first you're very good at math, but there's a lot of logical thinking, even in your science or your English or wherever. Most people like bankers and accountants would fit into this category. If you look at visual spatial, it's all about excelling in shapes and designs and graphics and visualization. Close your eyes and draw and the picture will come in front of you. And some people can draw and learn and write. Graphic organizers belong to this strategy. Musical, some people can learn only through music. or express learning through music, through rhythm, through rhyme. Bodily kinesthetic, yes, sports people, physical activities, but teachers are the examples of bodily kinesthetic. We use a lot of our voice, no doubt. The linguistic is there in us. We may have the logical, mathematical, we could have visual, but we use a lot of body kinesthetic when we speak to communicate. So actors, athletes, cricketers, you see all of them, they use a lot of their body language. And then you look at the interpersonal, the ability to organize people into groups and social relationship. And intra would be to understand one's own inner feeling. Today, reflective thinking is taking a huge lot of importance in educational circles. Self-realization, how do I know how to go into myself and reflect into what I've done so that I become a better learner? And naturalistic, one of the most important ones would be the natural flair and the love for nature and animals. And all of us don't have to be biologists or conservationists, but you have the green thumb. You love to have a garden of your own. And when you're traveling, you look out and see the different kinds of plants. When you visit a new place, you look at vegetation and animals there. It shows you're highly naturalistic. And existentialism, which is the ninth one and the recent one, is all about the mind, body, and the soul. So most of the spiritual leaders, the siddhas that we call about, all of them belong to this category. But you must remember that most of us also border on existentialism when we meditate, when we close our eyes, when we do a lot of reflection, we go deep into ourselves and ask a lot of questions about the inner self. The most important thing we should see from these intelligences that you can see on your screen is that we are endowed with all of these, but in varying degrees. So there could be an English teacher who's very, very strong in her linguistics, but could be equally good in naturalistic and in intrapersonal, and fairly good in musical, highly active in the bodily kinesthetic, and fairly adequate for visual spatial. So what is Gardner trying to convey when he says we are a combination of all these intelligences? Every child in the class is a combination. It has huge implications for using MI as a pedagogy, which we shall examine shortly. So take a look at this picture and interpret these pictures. You can see that multiple intelligences that are happening in a classroom signify a lot to a teacher. There's a teacher who's overseeing a class. So the same concept, two people are getting together and reading it, which means interpersonal is happening. Somebody's painting, somebody's writing a diary entry of the learning of that day. Somebody's on music. Can you see that somebody is making something with the hands, a model? So it means that a class has got these mixed abilities. And on the right hand side, look at the same activity for two children. One child can see the entire picture of the plane even before the child starts it. So this child is endowed with a different type of intelligence, but he's very spatial and can quickly, and you know, visualize it and then get ready with the kinesthetic part. But the other person, the girl, has to read instructions, go with the logical sequences, and she will also give you the same product. It also means that one, you teach through multiple products, as you can see on the left-hand side, and approach the same concept through multiple gateways to learning, or the same product is made, but with an approach to the different multiple intelligence. So ultimately, both make the same product, but the approach to making the product is different. So this has huge significance for us in the classroom as teachers to know that not all the children may get it in a step-to-step flow. Not all the children can get the whole picture together at one shot. So a teacher has to blend both or all of these in a very judicious manner so that she is able to, he or she is able to allow children to access the new learning through what is convenient and comfortable for that child. So once again, touching on the different intelligences, the verbal linguistic, as I pointed out, the characteristics would be more of the love for reading books, loving to give oral presentations with language, very good communication, written and oral, likes to participate in discussions and debates and to explain things because there's a language available for this person. So this person in your class could learn and learn best when they see words, when they read words, when they listen, and when they say. So do you have scope for this verbal linguistic in your classrooms? I'm sure you must be. And if you look at the logical mathematical, this is not for the math teachers, it's for all subject teachers. Do you have precise, accurate, logical thinking to the way children remember facts and figures and formulae? Is there a logic to the sequence of a war? Is there a logic to the sequence of a lesson and in literature and the flow? Is there a poetic device? Is there a rhythm in the poem? Is there all of that which shows the logic of that poem mathematically? So this would appeal to such children. So classifying, working with relationships and patterns would be how these children, the logical mathematical intelligence, would perform the best. Bodily kinesthetic is all about how much of physical activity and movement and awareness we have of our body and the sensory perception, the hearing, the seeing, the smelling, the feeling. So we talk about the visual, the auditory, children who love to read aloud, and then we have the kinesthetic, the VARK, as we call it, V-A-R-K. What are their characteristics? You find such children, they love to move around. You can't make them sit in a spot. They like to stand up and begin to answer. They love to touch and feel things before they talk. So there could be that logical child who draws step by step one flower, but there could be this child who is naturalistic and body kinesthetic, who wants to actually feel that flower. Good at sports, dancing, gymnastic. When they communicate, they use a lot of their body language, their hands, as you can see orators doing. So this person can touch, move about, interact with space, processing knowledge through body sensation. Look at the visual spatial, that mental image, like I told you all just now. The visual spatial will focus on mental images of what they see deep within, like the butterfly exercise we did now. Such children love to draw, to build, to design, to create. Most of the time you'll find them daydreaming because they're into some world of spatial intelligence. Highly imaginative. They love to watch movies because they can get into characters very fast. They're good at sensing change. They're good at puzzles because they can make their way out very fast. They can read, interpret charts and graphs. So this person can visualize, use colors and pictures and so on. Music rhythmic, as it says, sounds which have patterns, tone and pitch. So poetry, the reading that you do, literature reading that you do, science, textbooks, social studies, can you read aloud with proper intonation, which is nothing but a rhythmic one? Instead of a dull, straight voice, if you use your kinesthetics in your voice, there is a music and a rhythm in the voice when the teacher speaks, which means that children are able to relate when the voice has got kinesthetic in it. And basically, such children love to work with instruments. They pick up patterns, sounds, pitch, all that very fast. And this person would love to do anything connected with melody, rhythm, and music. Interpersonal, as I pointed out, is relationship with others. This person is very friendly, gregarious, has a lot of friends, can initiate dialogues with people, even with strangers, good at communication, even conflict resolution. They can mediate and talk when there's a problem. They can join groups very fast, create many groups. So they share, they're very good at collaboration. They can teach others very well because they are very good at interpersonal, peer counseling, peer tutoring, all that they are very strong at. Interest going within the self. Like I told you, reflective activities. So when we train our children to do reflection after the class is over, you're actually nurturing the intrapersonal intelligence in your children. They love to work alone. It's not to be looked upon as antisocial, that they don't like people. It is that they concentrate better when they are alone. And they're very self-aware, very sensitive to other people's feelings because they know about their own feelings very well. That's so good about these people. And they learn well when you leave them alone. That's why sometimes your class must have individual student work. then you have some time for peer discussion, sometimes group discussion. That's why your class routines have to change strategies to take care of all kinds of children. And naturalistic, as I already pointed out, the very natural love for nature and environment. They love to go out and look at nature. They love geography, learning more, not the textbook geography, but looking into what constitutes the geography of a place, why places are different, the weather, the environment. So these kids are very good at categorizing trees, plants, they can name them. They can organize very well because nature is very organized by nature. That's nature, the plants, the trees, the animal kingdom. It's all organized. So these children are good at that. They're very sensitive about preservation and conservation. And they love to work with animals and also with plants. So this person must be encouraged to look at cause effect, look at geography, how patterns work, work of nature, and use that strength to strengthen the classmates too. So what can we do as teachers now? If you talk about 40 children in a class and all of them having all of the intelligences but in varying degrees, so every child has got a combination of all these 9 but in different degrees, what do I do? How do I manage strategies? So some of the strategies I'm putting up on the screen you can see are: take a combination of strategies of linguistic, have storytelling for some time. So the ones who are good at this can either narrate a story that they know, they read stories or they write about it or listen to it, bring out strategies of this kind. This group can be actually initiated into that. Others would also improvise when you bring in the pedagogy of storytelling. If you look at the logical mathematical, it's very, very important to look at questioning logically. Give them brain teasers, experiments, calculations, number games, critical thinking activities, and ask them to put it into a logical framework. Even in literature, tell them to reframe the story and put it in a logical framework. Try and solve a problem there, critical problem solving. These kids would do very well. Socratic questioning, the why. They do it very well. And then look at spatial, the drawing, the mapping. So visualizing, coloring, mind mapping, graphs, videos. These are all materials you should be using. And strategies like ask children to see it, draw it, visualize it. And when you present also, try to use some of your presentations with mind maps, graphic organizers, drawing, so that it would appeal to this group also. Then we look at body kinesthetic. Ask children to build something, act on it. So they can't do it in an online class, fully agreed, but they can try out on their own at home. And body kinesthetic also means they can switch on a camera, read out the poem with body language, using gestures and dramatic expressions. Teachers could also do that, and so can the children. When you talk about intrapersonal, it's all about individualized attention for all children, and these children would really love it. Options when you ask them to study, self-esteem building, and ensuring that when you give them instructional strategies, give them connections to personal life. Why do you think saving water is important in your home? They connect immediately because their intrapersonal is so strong. Try to bring feeling into presentations. When you speak, appeal to the intrapersonal of children. Let them connect emotionally to themselves with you. Look at naturalistic. Connect your learning to the natural phenomena as much as you can. I'm not saying stretch it artificially and somehow peg it on to an intelligence, but when the context and the content lend themselves to these intelligences, tap it well. That is important. Same way with the music. Does your lesson permit children to create some formulae which they can have a rhythmic beat to? Can they use voice rhythmically to remember how they said something? Can you use your voice rhythmically with an up-down tone, especially when you want them to remember the sequence of certain events or dates or formulae? You try it out, it would work. And the interpersonal, getting children to work together, board games, group games, props for role plays, participating in role plays, writing out scripts together. There's a dynamic interaction happening between teacher and students, getting them to work, respecting interaction. All of these values come through instructional strategies and a sample of the teacher being the role model. So the big question is, where do I begin then when I know that these are different strategies? I could use a mix of all of these in all my classes. Not all of them, but those that lend themselves to my context or content. Fine. So where do I begin? I wish to share the simple experience that we did in my own school, where I gave a Google form to my teachers and I told them, we took about 16 of them for a sampling and said, just fill in this based on the statements you can see on your screen. I pride myself on a large vocabulary, which means you would be very linguistic. I love using numbers, would be math logical. I often look for weaknesses in myself, the intra. I enjoy being in the garden, so it's naturalistic. I don't get lost easily, could be very spatial. Whatever, so all of this I brought here and look at the profile of 16 of my teaching faculty members who decided to give me their responses. I told them to take only one which is the highest in their area of understanding. And I wonder about my life. 31% went into what we call the existentialism. What is the purpose of my life? I was myself surprised to see that this was the one that had the largest response. And after that was the one that went with, I like to be with different types of people, which means very intrapersonal. And that's very good for teachers to be intra and also, you know, existentialism. The purpose of a teacher's life is to mold the lives of children. So when they wonder about it, you see the power of the thought. And many of them have large vocabulary because as teachers, no matter which subject you teach, you would have a good vocabulary to manage your subject and so on. So what do we do then? So when I get this kind of a profile, the same Google form, I have a drop-down box and I tell children with these descriptors, you pick only one which strongly describes you out of others, the one which is highest. You would get a graph of this kind with 40 children of that section. This can be used by all the teachers, this finding. And based on this, what do? We look at what are the existing MIs which are very, very strong. As a teacher, I must strengthen them and build on that. What are the MIs that are a little low? So I have to look at that and work on this and strengthen this also through activities, because Gardner has proven through research that when you start working on intelligences of multiple intelligence, you can find a change in the level to the previous one. Unlike the IQ where people said, no, once it's done, you are labeled for life. But Gardner says you can strengthen what you already are strong in and you can work on what you are weak. Now, this is important for us as teachers and it's important for us to manage classes this way. So what do? First, take a whole class MI survey. Look at your class profile. Design your activities to strengthen MI, as you can see it on that survey. Tell your children to undertake that individual MI profile, which I will show you shortly. And every student can now see his or her strong multiple intelligence versus intelligence that needs strengthening. Now, this fifth point is different from the first one. The first one, the child will mark only one which is strongest, and that's for the use of the teacher to strengthen her class intelligences. This is for children to visit literacynet.org, MI assessment, find out your strength, ask them to do it, and children will know their own MIs and where they stand versus where they need to improve. Overall, all the nine intelligences every child can explore. It's a free website available. The sixth thing a teacher can do after you've seen four is you design a choice board of MI that have clear criteria. So give your children, whenever you have projects, extension activity, now CBSE speaks about enrichment activities, you can give two or three choice boards for children. So one group, you can say you can either write a poem, so you're tapping the literary skills as well as you're tapping the rhythmic skills, or tell children draw a poster and write a note on that. Look at the reflective intrapersonal versus the spatial intelligence. And you can give another, but ensure that your evaluation criteria is equitable for all the three. They should not have a disadvantage with any one product. So be a little careful, but do choice board. You go to the internet and ask for choice board activities based on MI, you'll have plenty of them dropping down at your doorstep virtually. And then tell children to select based on their needs. This is something I did on my own just to show you how it's happening. So once you get into the website, you'll find this there, find your strength and five statements there. And all of these to be answered. You can see that. And finally, I get my profile telling me that this is my language is my strongest strength. Top three intelligences would be language, would be intrapersonal, and would be social, interpersonal. These are supposed to be my top three intelligences. And other areas where I need to work on personally would be the body kinesthetic, it says, nature I have to work on, musical intelligence, logical math, and spatial. Ask your children to do this so that they know what are their top three strengths and areas where they have scope for improvisation. So every child can start working on their own personal intelligences too. Now we come to the next part. How do I make sure that I'm applying these multiple intelligences in my class? So when you take any plan where you want to bring in all the intelligences, please examine your lesson content and check out throughout that lesson, where do you have the scope for bringing in music or environmental sounds in that lesson? Check it out, mark it as musical intelligence. Again, read the content of that lesson and see where can I bring in the intrapersonal. Third, look at how can I incorporate living things, natural phenomena, and other things for the naturalist. Does my lesson contain scope for this? How do I bring in numbers and calculations when I do literature? Is there a scope for number? Do I have rhythm A, A, B, B, C, C, and all that? So that would be something like a logical sequence. Can children calculate how the poet must have used this? How many words had alliteration and so on? Classification of all the poetical devices would come here. Same way for science, same way for math, for social. Spatial, where can I use visual aids? Where can children draw? Linguistic, where can children present themselves in my lesson? Then where can I give scope for group work to happen? Can children go into channels and do some work where peer sharing, learning is happening? Then where do I allow my children to use whole body, hands-on? They can go home and take a recording of a poem that you want them to recite. Ask them to take a video recording. That's nothing but body kinesthetic. You can see on your own video. Ask them to send it to you. Sometimes unmute a group and tell them, now come on, narrate the poem with body action. I like to see your video cameras on. So the teacher has to examine every lesson and look at the scope that the intelligences have. Search for that. Next, I'm moving on to a few samples. So if you look at biology and the topic called the levels of classification, I got this from lessonplanet.com, which has a lot of lesson plan ideas for teachers on MI. Here, in the levels of classification, I think we all know about classification in biology. So the linguistic part, children can create mnemonic devices to remember the order of the classification. Math logical, ask children to use their description of the levels, make sure that each kingdom becomes specific as you classify. Play and present to the class. Look at mathematics. Topic given is the elements of a cube. Music. How do I involve music into the topic of the cube elements? Where do you think I can bring in the rhythm here? Intrapersonal. How to encourage personal feeling and self-reflection on the topic of cubes? Where all do I find cubes? How are ice cubes related to my learning of mathematical cubes? Can I draw the cube? How do I describe the various kind of cubes I have? I'll be getting into linguistic. How do I use visual color need in art for cubes? How to calculate the volume of a cube, the external surface of a cube? Why are both different? So the logical will come in. Then get children to actively participate in making a model and talking about elements of cube. Can I bring physical movements of my hand itself to show that a cube is made this way? I just use my hands, because when I use my hands, my memory is triggered for the cube. If you take photosynthesis, the same thing. How do they compare in existentialism the role of photosynthesis and their own? What's happening to me versus what's happening to the plants? And the role of photosynthesis in the environment. In body kinesthetic, play characters involved in that formula of photosynthesis, including the plant and the sun and other elements. Can they draw? Learners can create a timeline of the steps of photosynthesis. Then they read materials to extend beyond text and then explain to the class. Through small discussions, talk about photosynthesis, draw a parallel. How does it connect with our lives? Any other interpersonal activity? What sounds do you think nature makes silently when this process of photosynthesis is happening? And you'll have some children playing a violin or somebody playing the flute and saying, this looks like what happens during photosynthesis. So give everybody the opportunity to write even a journal entry. And when they do this journey of exploring intelligences through these activities, so every lesson, end of lesson, when you have an enrichment activity, try to create 3-4 such products, or even 2 or 3 products which will combine intelligences together, but ensure you have proper criteria for guiding your children on their quality of product. That's very important. Kindergarten, even while teaching the letter D, the big D and the small D, or the capital letter D and the small letter D, you can ask children, what does this letter look like? Does it look like A or a B or a C? Which one does it resemble? So the children look at that logic even in that level. What shapes do you see when you write this letter? And these children, because their world is slowly expanding, they will give you their own language. The D resembles something that they saw, maybe the edge of a spoon or the round of their tongue. You never know. Make up sounds that go with the shapes you're drawing. So tell children, as you draw the D, what kind of sound you would like to make, and you can have that pitter-patter sound. Body kinesthetic. Use your hands and try and draw the D with your partner. So many are there, interpersonal. Coach somebody in the class who's slow in writing to write the letter D. Build peer relationships in this level. What are some of the things we do with the letter D in our lives? So give me names of all the things you know that start with D. And these little children will tell you the intra, where it connects within themselves. Practice writing on sand. Can you see this letter in nature? They'll go and see, yes, yes. So many twigs resemble the letter D. Tell a story, start writing at the top and tell me, mostly using the letter D, or give a character with D, use many other characters with D, try to use action words with D and make a story. And children will start, you're exploring the world of language through this. And as we can all see, one activity does not restrict itself to a specific intelligence. Because when you touch one intelligence, it's like a web. You're touching all the other 9 also unknowingly and tapping them. That is important. And that's why Gardner says the biggest mistake of past centuries in teaching has been to treat all students as if they were variants of the same individual, and so feel justified in teaching them all the same subjects the same way. So this was the biggest mistake, according to Gardner. treating all students as if they are the representation of one child they know well about. Biggest mistake. And we all know this well-known cartoon which hit educational circles some time back on assessment. Everybody, the teacher says, for a fair selection, you have to take the same exam. Ironically, we are doing just that. I want everyone to start climbing that tree first. So section A of question paper, ability to climb the tree. So what do you think will happen? The monkey would get the highest marks there and be very happy. The crow will fly up. The penguin can do nothing. The elephant can only plod and try and shake the tree. The goldfish is gone with a zero. The seal or the walrus gives up. And the fox says, that's not the tree I can climb. And then you give them another one and say, now you run. How many of these creatures can run? Uproot a tree. How many can uproot a tree? So this is the irony of testing. Multiple intelligence, multiple modes of testing would be fair to all. Everyone feels it's a fair examination. Yes, we do not have the courage to do it because examinations, high stake, do not recognize the scope for so many intelligences. But as teachers, can we use the freedom given within our own lessons in our own schools to allow these intelligences to flourish? And you can be sure when you nourish